All right, folks, let's find our way back to our seats and we'll roll this morning and jump into God's Word together. I'm really excited to do this, and we got a lot going today, so I'm going to jump right in this morning. We're in the final week of a series that we've called Deadly Individualism. And the cool part is that we've looked as an overview of the book of Hebrews over the last 3 weeks together as a church. And it's been wonderful to do this, really talking about what it means to be part of the church. And we are here to kind of debunk the idea that you can follow Jesus without any meaningful involvement in the life of the local church. And it's just not true. It's a false dichotomy, and we don't want to do a series here out of self motives of some sort, or to make you feel like we're forcing you or coercing you to be here because of us. This is for your good and the hope that God has in building into a community of faith with you as part of it, and that becomes part of your growth and development as a Christian and meeting Jesus and connecting with him on a regular basis. So just the fact that you're here is a wonderful thing this morning. And really one of my hopes this morning as we jump into the kind of the final part of this is to give you a perspective of what it means to come and be a part of the local church, specifically when you gather together like this, when we gather together as a local church. And my hope is to give you some perspective on that this morning from Hebrews chapter 12. So if you have your Bibles, you're welcome to open to Hebrews 12. If you don't, we'll have the words behind us on the screen. While you're turning there, let me tell you a little bit about Imprint Church for just a second. Little did you know this, but Imprint Church has a little conflict among its staff right now. It's funny, it's not what you think. It's actually based on the space that we share over in this little room right there, all right? This is our offices, and we have four boys, men, if you will, that share that office together. And it's very small. You can see it. There's not much room in there. And we've made some cubicles to get the work done and things like that. But the cubicles are a little bit see-through, and we sometimes watch YouTube videos and stuff, so we don't get all the things done that we need to. But what's happened is there's some conflict there, and the conflict all has to do with this thing called the thermostat, all right? What's really weird about this is that there's two of us on the lead team here who tend to think the thermostat should be pumped way, way higher than it really ought to be. And so, like, that's no names at all, but Tom and Ben do that all the time. And it drives me crazy, all right? I haven't figured out Justin yet. I'm not sure whether he's part of this conspiracy or not to turn the heat all the way up. But it's funny, I'll be out having lunch with someone, and I'll come back in. And it's really great because I'll wander in for a second. Coming in from the cold, the 77 degrees feels great, right? For 5 minutes. And then I start sweating. And so I'm shedding clothes, and I just got done eating, so I'm comfortable and tired and all this kind of stuff, and I just can't pay attention anymore, and so I get up, make some sarcastic comment, look at the note, and turn the heat back down. I don't know what it is. Tom started here before we actually had heat in that building, and so this building, if you don't know, is the worst when it comes to having any kind of insulation or whatever it is, so it's just basically we got to heat the outside when you're sitting in here in some way, and so Tom came in there, so I don't know if he just thinks the heat's going to go away at some point, so he turns it way higher, whatever it is. But that is the case. And so what's happened with me is I kind of feel like the dad of this place nowadays, right? You know what I mean? Like, didn't dad in your house always turn the thermostat down? Isn't that true? Like, no matter what? And he would tell you he's going to cut your fingers off if you touch that thermostat in some way, shape, or form, right? That was like this. So I've become like dad around here, like making sure I'm doing something to make sure the heat doesn't turn up so high and that Satan himself doesn't feel comfortable in this building, all right? That's been my big goal, all right? But, you know, the reason why I bring that up is because a thermostat's a funny thing. I remember right after I became a Christian, I went to a youth group. I visited a friend's youth group as a high school kid. And it's really funny because there was a youth pastor who shared his message that day. And I don't remember all the sermons I've heard. I don't remember half the sermons I've preached, right? But what happened is this guy got up there and shared a sermon one day. And it was probably based on kind of moralism. It was probably on peer pressure and things like that. But what he did is he shared about being different than the world around you. And he talked about the difference between a thermostat and a thermometer. And I remembered this very clearly, and I remember this day. He said, a thermostat is something that changes the temperature in the room, like Tom and Ben do in that little room right there, right? And then the thermometer is something that changes based on the temperature of the room. And his big point, the big crescendo, is like, you should be a thermostat, you know, not a thermometer. And it was all probably about peer pressure. I don't remember all of the sermon, but it stuck with me, honestly, that idea of being a thermostat instead of a thermometer. And in some ways, my sermon today is to help you actually be a thermostat around Imprint Church. Now, not in a moralism way, but in a way that's helpful for you, helpful for our body, and ultimately leads to the glory of Jesus that we just sang about a minute ago. I don't know if you know this, but you have a lot of power here when you show up. You, personally. You might say, I've only been here twice, but you carry yourself in here with all your hopes, all your dreams, all your baggage, all your attitude, all of that you bring into Imprint Church. And it's weird because we feel it. We feel it in here as a church community. You may not know that, but we literally do. I've noticed this within the community of Christ, that people bring their hopes, their dreams, their bad attitudes and things like that, and it affects the worship of the morning. It affects the whole thing. I noticed this really well when I was a student at Multnomah Bible College many, many years ago, and I became a worship leader there. Now, when I was a worship leader there, I was asked to help lead worship for about 1,000 people, 800 to 1,000 people that were part of the Bible college and seminary. We met at a big school or a big church next door, and I get to lead worship on Mondays and Thursdays there. Depending on the week, it was Monday or Thursday. And I always struggled with a little bit because it was just a big crowd. We had a good band and all that kind of stuff. But what was really amazing is I noticed something really unique about leading worship at Multnomah, and that's this. It was the easiest worship leading I've ever done in my life. Now, the reason why I think, and I don't have empirical proof. Maybe I do have empirical proof. I have experiential proof in a way, but I don't have some Bible passage to back this up. But what's really interesting is these folks, these young people from college and seminary students and professors who were in the Word every day, seeking Jesus, wanting to go in ministry, when they got to worship, it just overflowed from them. There was something about it that was compelling. And in some ways, I could have stunk up there because it is carried along. It was like being carried along by the Holy Spirit when I was doing that. I actually remember one time in particular, I was leading worship at, they had a retreat basically is what they did, and they brought in a bunch of people from all over kind of the West Coast to come in to see the college, to see if they wanted to be a part of it. And it was called Preview, and I was asked to be the worship leader for that. And so if I remember right, my wife and I actually did this together, and we had a good band behind us, and so we gathered together and worshiped. And I remember like playing the first chord of the song and just the boom that happened from everyone. It's just like I was being carried with them in the praises that they were singing. It was amazing. There was this feeling of like overwhelming sense of awe that God was in that place and he was ready to meet with all the people there. And it came from their attitude. It came from their experience. The truth is this, I've learned something over the years that our personal preparation, yours and my personal preparation, our attitude and condition of our souls sets the tone for people's experience of the living God when the church of God gathers together. Do you know that? It's kind of strange to say that. A lot of people rely on the pastor. Maybe he's funny. Maybe he's got lots of energy. Maybe he can help get us there in some ways. But you know what? You play as much of a part as that as anyone who stands on stage, whether by music or by message. Your experience here, you bring it with us, and you help us experience the grace of God in this place. The reason why is because when we have a heart attitude that's filled with expectation to meet with God, I believe he honors that and does show up. He shows up. Now you may say to me, man, I don't know anything about God. I was invited by my friend. This is my first time here. I don't know Jesus. I don't know the Bible. I'm here because I just needed to be here. And you know what? That is wonderful. It is a great thing you're here. And we're not expecting you to conjure up some sort of emotional feeling or something like that, or even believe all the things we do. We'd ask you to consider the things we placed before you today and consider Jesus as we look to him in just a minute through Hebrews 12. But for those of us in here who know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, your expectation coming in here, the attitude that you bring in here is so important for the rest of us. So important for us as we meet with Christ together. It doesn't mean you have to be perfect. Hear me, folks. It doesn't mean you have to not deal with sin that week, because just be honest, you will deal with sin this last week. You will deal with sin next week. And unfortunately, until Jesus returns, we will continue to deal with sin. But the hope is we bring that stuff to God. We bring in our hurts, our desperation. We bring our excitement, we bring our anticipation, we bring our hope, our purpose. We bring in sometimes even a contemplative spirit. Bring all of those things to Imprint Church when we gather together, folks, whether by gathering as a big group like now or a small group in a generosity group later. Bring all of that stuff. Just let me implore you for a moment. Do not come to church ambivalent, all right? Don't come to church with just this attitude of like, I've always done this. I do it because I'm trying to earn God's favor. Or maybe it's just part of the pattern of your life, all right? Come with this anticipatory feeling of saying, I get to meet with God this morning. I get to meet with Jesus, and it is the best thing that I could do with my morning. And the funny thing is, we fight for affections, don't we? As you think about this, we fight for the affections of our day, whether by Seahawks game or by shopping or by our beds, which has my affection all the time, right? I love my bed. I don't want to get out of it, you know? Like, it's so wonderful. We fight those things. And yet our affections when we come to church are to be towards Jesus and the anticipation of getting to meet him. Some of you might say to me, well, that doesn't sound all that good, honestly. Like, my life is not all put together and I feel guilty about the things. And isn't God just here to make me feel guilty about my life? And I would say no. In fact, Hebrews 12 today is going to tell us something vastly different about what you come to when you come to God and come to the church and gather with the saints of God. A vision, a hope that you might have as we read this passage today to give you this anticipatory heart feeling as we look at it together. So let's see what Hebrews 12 says together, and let's hear what it is to meet with the living God and what the author of Hebrews tells us we should anticipate when we gather together. All right, it's a little strange. We'll read it and we'll break it down a little bit together, but I think you'll catch it at the very end of our time together. Let's read together in Hebrews 12, verses 1 through 3, and then we'll skip down a little bit after that. The author of Hebrews writes this, Hebrews 12, 1, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted." Skip down to verse 12. The next few verses are about God's discipline of his children. It's a great thing, but we're not have time to jump into that today. But jump down to verse 12. "Therefore, lift your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Strive for peace with everyone, for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled. That no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. For you know that afterward, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no chance to repent, though he sought it with tears. For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel." Skip down to verse 28. "Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire." Words here that are somewhat unique and somewhat clouded within the veil of the Old Testament in some way. If you don't know the story of the Exodus, we'll look at it in just a second, you may wonder what is going on here. But words that bring about this sense of what it means to gather with the living God, to meet with Jesus, to connect with him on a regular basis, with the assembly of the saints, and what happens in some ways in the heavenlies when we do that. Things that we can't even see that are happening around us right here and right now. The author of Hebrews is telling us what we should really understand when we gather together. And let's think about the context of Hebrews as we work through this passage a little bit. The book of Hebrews is all about Jesus. You'll find that out if you read the book of Hebrews. You'll find that he came to earth in human flesh as the perfect manifestation of God on earth. We find out in Hebrews he is superior to the angels, to Moses, to the priesthood is what we find out in the first few chapters of Hebrews. His dwelling place is at the right hand of the Father, which is superior now to the tabernacle, we read in Hebrews as well. The new covenant, which he established by shedding his blood, is superior to the old and is once for all sacrifice for the sins that we commit, brings salvation to each one of us, is what the author of Hebrews is arguing. And because of that sacrifice, men and women, all of us here this morning, are able to draw near to God by faith and experience his loving presence in the new life that he gives. And then it's funny because Hebrews turns a corner and starts to warn the believers about things in Hebrews chapter 10 to encourage people in their faith and warning against deliberately living in sin. If you've experienced this God, this new covenant, this Jesus that it talks about, we should not continue to live in sin in chapter 10, verses 26 through 31. And then this warning is followed by an encouragement to be people who are faithfully serving and persevering through amidst of persecution in our lives. And that leads us up to chapter 11 and 12 and what we see here. What we see here is chapter 11 is the famous faith chapter. All the people who had faith in God. The author demonstrates that people didn't gain God's approval by their faith in the things that they did, but rather through Jesus Christ. Salvation becomes this result of God's work through Jesus on Calvary, and men and women aren't saved by their good works, but on the basis of their faith in Jesus Christ, which leads us to chapter 12. It reminds us here that the Christians who read this have a great host of witnesses looking on after us, witnessing us, seeing the race that we are running. And the author encourages us to run with endurance. We are to do this with our eyes fixed on Jesus, who is the founder and finisher of our faith there in 12:1-3. And then, as I said just a minute ago, there's a chunk on enduring suffering and discipline as God's children. But then it turns to talk about ministering to other people in the midst of the church community, is what it says here, for the good of the church in 12 verses 14 and 17. And then it leads the author to contrast something here, which I want to get to today. And that says these two mountains, these two pictures of mountains in the Old Testament. One is Mount Sinai, where the law was given. We're going to read about in Exodus 19 in just a second and 20. And the other is Mount Zion, the place, the heavenly place where some mysterious way, when we gather as a church, we take part in the heavenly gathering of Mount Zion. Some eschatological, weird, crazy, amazing things happen that we are pulled out of reality right now to a higher reality of seeing God exalted on the throne in a majorly cool way. And we see it here. We get this picture of how we are to be worshipers as well. And what's amazing is the author of Hebrews tells us to do something as we jump into this new mountain, to move past Mount Sinai and go into the Mount Zion, to enter with the festal angels and the gathering of the saints who are enrolled in heaven. He says to do something in chapter 12. And I don't know if you saw it, but it's all about Jesus. He says in verse 2, to look to Jesus is what he says. And then in verse 3, he says, consider Jesus, is what he says. And then finally in verses 22 through 24, he says, come to Jesus. You see that? The progression here? Look at Jesus. Consider him, the things that he did, and then come to him. It's the picture of the progression of Hebrews chapter 12 as you're looking at it. If you want an outline of what Hebrews chapter 12 is, that's it. It's all about Jesus, us considering, looking to him, and then coming to him, our mediator of the new covenant, who is our Savior and Lord. Right now, he's at the center of the throne, on the throne being worshipped by the assembled universe, and in some mysterious way, we're part of that gathering today. That's what we do. When we were singing All Glory Be to Christ a minute ago, can you picture us joining with the throng of angels, a host of heaven, people all over the world, millions of people who are worshiping Jesus right now. If that doesn't get you excited, I don't know what does. It's such a beautiful picture. Moreover, the author of Hebrews tells us to consider that the blood of the sprinkled blood of animals and things like that aren't enough to draw us near to God like the Old Testament way when they would have to offer sacrifices. But now because of the sprinkled blood of Jesus Christ, we can gather by faith to him. We can bring our hearts to him. We can gather in confidence and approach the throne of grace, as the Bible says, that we might help, find help in our time of need. It's this idea that we've had something happen between the Old Testament covenant where there was ceremony, where there was things that you had to do to get to God, to the New Testament picture of Jesus who makes a way for us to come to God right now. Look, consider, come to Jesus. Man, the first thing you can do in the book of Hebrews as you read this thing is recognize who Jesus is and turn and surrender. your life over to Him. Some of you know what this means. Some of you do not. Some of you have misconceptions of this even as to what it is. I think most of us, when we think about church, especially if we have experience not in the church as a kid, we think of church as this way, as when we go to church, we go there to get religion, to get some sort of religion. You know what religion says to people? It says, try harder to be approved, is what it says. Religion is all about trying hard to gain the approval of God so that you'll be approved by Him and accepted by Him. But Hebrews is blasting this in the face and saying, that's not it. You have a better covenant, a new way of viewing your relationship with God by faith. And this is Jesus in the gospel, where the gospel says, come to Jesus and let the grace that I offer you through Christ, the grace of God, transform you. That's what you see in the gospel. That's what you're coming to when you come to a church that worships Jesus. You're finding what I like to say is a new reality of life in Christ every week when you gather. And it should give you great hope. It should raise your hopes in your hearts no matter what's been going on in your life. And then there's this big contrast here. Again, what I said just a minute ago. One is Mount Sinai, the mountain where God gives the law. And the other is Mount Zion, which is not in earthly Jerusalem. We see this here. It's heavenly Jerusalem. It's the contrast between Mount Sinai, the law given, and the heavenly mountain where the redeemed people of God are living in glory that somehow we're transported to as we worship. Let's briefly look at the contrast between two mountains. If you turn back with me, you can, to Exodus chapter 19. I'll have the words with me on here. But I want to show you what happened here just to give you the context of this and to see the law given at Mount Sinai and then see what Jesus offers us as a contrast to this. In Exodus 19, this is what Hebrews is referring to in verses 16 and following. Moses is receiving the law from God. And it's this weird picture because only Moses is allowed to go and approach God at this time. And it's what's really amazing is you see the people's response in this from verse 16 and following. It says this, on the mountain on the third day, there was thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast so that all the people in the camp trembled. They're fearful, freaking out about what's going on. Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God. And they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. The smoke of it went up like the smoke of a kiln, and the whole mountain trembled greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. The Lord God came down on Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses then went up there. And the Lord said to Moses, go down and warn the people lest they break through to the Lord to look, and many of them perish. Also let the priests who come near to the Lord consecrate themselves, lest the Lord break out against them. And Moses said to the Lord, the people cannot come up to Mount Sinai, for you yourself warned us, saying, set limits around the mountain and consecrate it. And the Lord said to him, Go down and come up, bringing Aaron with you, but do not let the priests and the people break through to come up to the Lord, lest you break out against them. So Moses went down to the people and told them all these things. Then the Ten Commandments are given right after this moment. You see this moment happen. The Ten Commandments are given to the people. And I want you to see the response of the people right after this that we look at in chapter 20, verse 18 and 19. And see what happens. This is the voice of the people. This is the voice of God coming down, giving the law, and the gathered people together. And they say something really intense here in chapter 20, verses 18 and 19, right after the law was given. It says this, now when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning, very similar to what we see in Hebrews, and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled, and they stood far off, backed up, right? You might too, honestly. And said to Moses, you speak to us, and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us, lest we die. Don't let God speak to us. Did you catch what's happening here? Told them not to go up to the mountain for a reason. The people back way back. Keep going. Move back further. Actually, don't even let God speak to us, lest we die. We don't want to come anywhere near this Mount Sinai. We don't want to go there. This is God revealing himself to the people, giving the law to the people, and they're told not to come close. And what's amazing is how the author of Hebrews contrasts what our life is like now compared to life is like back at the Mount Sinai moment with the people of Israel. The people were absolutely awed in hearing God speak, but it scared them to death, to the point where they said, to Moses, whenever God says something, would you mind just being a mediator for us? We don't want to hear it directly. We don't want to go up there. We don't want to go near. Let him speak and you tell us what he said, all right? That's what the people were saying. And this is contrasted in Hebrews 12 with Mount Zion. No longer will people experience the thunder and lightning and the pyrotechnics and not coming close to the mountain, but rather we're invited, what? To a mountain. How amazing is that? Don't go to that mountain. Go to the other mountain. There's a mountain where I want you to experience my grace given through Jesus Christ, is what the author of Hebrews tells us there. Where Mount Zion represents this spiritual city and this spiritual kingdom, and we're all invited to join in that. And so just as Esau had to make the choice between a bowl of soup and God's promised blessing, so we are invited to join either a present earthly Jewish kingdom like Mount Sinai, where God remains at a distance from us and we don't go anywhere near him, and the heavenly Mount Zion, where you're invited to come, to consider, to look, and see Jesus in those places. Furthermore, we are told that we've come to innumerable angels in festal gatherings. We're told that there's others worshiping around the throne with us, things that we can't even see. We know this mass of the host of the heavenly people are doing this at the wedding supper of the Lamb, as we just got done reading in Revelation and studying in Revelation, that there is celebration going on there and that we've been invited to that. And the author of Hebrews, if you flip back to Hebrews 12, calls this the assembly of the firstborn, the ones who are enrolled in God's kingdom. This idea that we've been invited, we've been given the life that Christ has given to us, new life in Christ. Our name is written in the book of life, that we can gather together and we get a chance to take part in the worship of Jesus each and every week. This is amazing. This is the theology of why we worship. This is the theology of why we gather. It's not to stand at a distance and look to see what's happening and be afraid of God, where religion tells you to try harder to be approved by God. It's the invitation to come to Mount Zion, to gather before him, to worship him who is near to us, who wants to give us life each and every week when we gather in this place. And somehow, as I said a minute ago, the church experiences this new reality of life in Christ every time they gather. That's the point of it. That's the hope of it. That's why your attitude is so important when you gather here. What do you expect? What do you expect? Do you expect to meet with Jesus? Or do you expect to stand at a distance and just see what's happening and not respond to the Lord? Theologian William Lane Craig comments on Hebrews, and I thought it was beautiful what he said. He's a Biola guy. He said this, "Every aspect of the vision that we see in Hebrews provides encouragement for coming boldly into the presence of God." That's what he says. "The atmosphere of Mount Zion is festive. The frightening visual imagery of blazing fire, of darkness, of gloom, fades before the reality of the city of the living God, heavenly Jerusalem." Sinai goes away, in other words. "The cacophony of whirlwind, trumpet blast, and the sound of words is muted and replaced by the joyful praise of angels in festal gathering. The trembling congregation of Israel, gathered solemnly at the base of a mountain, is superseded by the assembly of those names who are permanently inscribed in the heavenly archives. An overwhelming impression of the unapproachability of God is now eclipsed in the experience of full access to the presence of God and to Jesus, that mediator of the new covenant." You catch that? The author's picture of the gathered assembly at Mount Zion here just sends out this feeling of warmth, of invitation, of relationship set in bold display against the religious work of Sinai in the old covenant. From the earliest days, the Christian community has had a call for you to come and experience the grace of God. It's been central to the church's mission. It's been central to all our messages at Imprint Church for the last 4.5 years, is to invite you to come to that. Do you know what you're coming to when you come to the Lord? Do you know what we're inviting you to when we ask you to come to a new reality of life in Jesus Christ? It's to walk past Sinai, experience what law is, the hurt of not following God's commandments, being a person who is sinful and broken in all ways. But don't stop there. Don't stop there. Walk past it. See the brokenness in the middle of Sinai, not being able to approach God. See your separation from God and understand that. But Hebrews invites us then to walk right past it and walk into the presence of God in fullness of faith, believing that he is with us and he wants to offer us new life in Christ. So Hebrews 12 is talking about folks
It's this picture, an invitation for us. And although it is true that the path to Zion brushes past Sinai and the holiness of God becomes a foundational idea of the message of true grace, we won't understand what grace is unless we understand our own brokenness. Zion here looms large in the vision of what it means to gather with the church of Christ. It's what it does. Don't remind yourself of the brokenness and stuff. Come to experience a new life in Christ. Doesn't mean you don't come and reflect on the sins and the brokenness in your life. Doesn't mean you don't do any of those things. It means rather you take care of them so you could come to the church and experience the grace of God poured out. Why do you think right before this picture of the two mountains in Hebrews, in verses 12 and following, it talks about being people who are doing these various things before they gather with the assemblies of God? They say this in Hebrews 12, 14 through 16, strive for peace with everyone. Strive for holiness. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God. It's things the author of Hebrews says. See to it that no root of bitterness springs up among you, and see to it that no one is sexually immoral. It's this picture of taking care of some of those things before you gather with the assembly of the saints to be able to be people who deal with those. That's why it even starts off with the words for in verse 18. Therefore, because of these things, because you've taken care of the brokenness in your life, you get to gather with the saints of God and worship together. It's almost like those things that you see up here are the grace killers. That if you come to church with these things, it creates that somber mood. Take care of these things. Take care of the bitterness in our hearts. Take care of the sexual immorality that we deal with more constantly nowadays with the internet, the brokenness of pornography and stuff in our own world. Take care of that stuff. Come to the Lord. Experience His grace here in this place and experience new life in Christ. That's the picture. So the church here gives us a place of grace which transforms our lives, ultimately in the way of preparation coming to the church so we might experience the grace of God in a great way. In conclusion here, look with me at verses 28 and 29. In light of all this, the author summarizes and says these words. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which may be offered to God the acceptable servants with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. That's what it says here. Do you see what happened here? We wandered past Sinai. We got to Mount Zion. We wandered back to Sinai, didn't we? God is a consuming fire here. This picture of us coming back to the idea of who God really is. It even says at one point that He is the judge of all men in verse, I think, 23 in here, where it says God is the judge of all men at that point. We're reminded of the complexity of who God is, that He brings us to Himself by His grace, but reminds us how far we have wandered at times as well. And this picture here of God as a consuming fire is this picture of something greater than anything we see there at Sinai. The grace of God is this picture of burning things up in our lives. The brokenness that we bring in here that God wants to burn up in our lives so we can come and experience hope and life in Christ. I don't know if you can read this passage without having your heart sore about coming to gather with the church. I don't know if you can read this passage without coming here as a thermostat. Oh man, I get to wander past Sinai today. I get to wander past that. I get to experience Zion, the heavenly city, with brothers and sisters joining the company of angels around me, worshiping before the throne, to be reminded of my own brokenness, but yet be reminded mostly of the great grace of God. Folks, Imprint Church is not impressive by any standards at all. We don't have phasers and fog and lights and things like that. I imagine there's churches that do that. There's probably good reasons for that at various times. But you know what? You get to meet with God when you come here. You get to experience the grace of God, the God who is a consuming fire, the God who we come before and experience that hope of new reality of life in Christ. This is the definition of impressive in my mind. Your expectation, your hopes, your things that you bring here is exciting and hoping for us as we gather as a church that you bring in this attitude each and every week. In some ways, my whole sermon today is just to prepare you to come to church on a regular basis, to be here with the expectation that you get to do this. We get to gather together. We get to sing. We get to worship. We get to bring our hopes, our fears, our everything to God and experience true transformation by what He's done to us, to bring us through Sinai to Zion, to the heavenly city where God is waiting for us to experience His love and His grace. We get to respond to the Lord this morning. My hope for you this morning is that I have almost just inspired you. Didn't have a lot of instruction for you today. I had a lot of inspiration, I did. And the hope of this is to turn our hopes and excitement to our response time. We're going to sing some songs here in just a second. And as we sing these songs, man, you're coming to Zion, folks. You're coming to the heavenly city. You're joining with the angels. You're worshiping. Allow yourself to get lost in that. Don't fear what other people are doing around you. Come to Jesus this morning. During this next few minutes, we're going to do all kinds of really cool things as we sing some songs together. We're going to be able to receive communion. We only have communion on one table this morning. And in just a minute, we actually are going to have our kids join us for baptisms. And so it's going to be chaotic in here, all right? We'll be festal gathering together, all right? As we'll be doing, all right? It's like the angels are doing in Hebrews chapter 12. And during the first couple songs, you're welcome to come and receive communion. You're even welcome to during the third song in just a second here. But kids will be moving around and things like that as well. You can come and receive communion if you'd like to. On this table, there's a gluten-free option over there if you want, but come to the Lord in hope of what he offers you in the picture of Mount Zion. There's a giving basket over here if you want to come and give. By the way, take your bread and dip that in the cup if you're not familiar with receiving communion here at Imprint Church. You can receive it right there at the table. You can wander around in our room anywhere you want to. People would be willing to pray for you today. Maybe you don't know this Jesus who we talked about. You've not wandered past Sinai. You haven't experienced the grace of God that Jesus offers to us. You haven't considered and looked, and you haven't come to Jesus. You get a chance to do that today if you want to. In a couple songs, we get to experience the hope of baptism, where we actually watch people literally move past Sinai to new life in Christ, which would be such a cool thing. And a couple of you are going to be baptized. I'll turn it over to Tom in just a minute. But as we sing these songs, my hope for you is that you're inspired to bring your hearts to be that thermostat, to set the tone of the room as we get to enter into the presence of the Most High God who loves us, who is our indeed consuming fire, to help us burn all the dross, all the messed up things in our life away, that we can experience his grace and hope each and every day. Can you say amen to that? Let's pray together. God, I'm so grateful for these words. It's just, in some ways, inspirational to me. As I read it this last week, and as I thought about these things, I know that sometimes my own heart is not so excited to come to church, and I don't have this attitude, but I pray that you'd change that in me, change that in us, that we'd experience this hope, this hope of Christ each and every day as we gather together. Lord, may we do it in both the corporate gathering here at Imprint Church. May we do it in the individual gatherings in our homes as we gather with the people of God. And may we at that point experience the grace of God together, I would pray. Lord, as we celebrate and respond to you now, Lord, would you give us the ability to see beyond what is just happening in this room and experience the grace of God transforming our lives each and every day. Lord, we are so grateful to get a chance to worship. May we respond to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.